This program was paid for by Water of Life Church. From Water of Life Ministries in Plano, Texas, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is speaking through his servants to the world. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying today. Let us join Doyle Davidson and others of Water of Life, sowing the Word of God in spirit and in truth.
Hello, and all this servant and apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, ministering locally to the body of Christ in Dallas, in Fort Worth, Texas, sent by God to your house to declare unto you the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 15, 3 and 4, tell us what the gospel is. Now that Jesus Christ died for our sins, according to Scripture, he was buried. He rose again the third day, according to the Scripture. Amen. Thank God. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, as he's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, sent me to heal broken hearted, preach deliverance to the captives, give good sight to the blind, set at liberty them that are bruised. What is thy thee? And in your heart, in your mouth, there's a word of faith which I preach. You confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus. Believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead. You shall be saved. With the heart, man believeth unto righteousness. With the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation. Everyone that believe it. The Jew first. Also, Jew the Greek. There is the righteousness. God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, just to live by his faith. I want to welcome everyone to this broadcast, receiving it on live stream. Thank God, Roku, Apple TV, YouTube, other devices, Kathie, Davidson, to my left. How are you?
Doing well.
A prophetess, right?
Yes.
She said, you begin to bother me with this. I said, good, you're a prophetess, right?
That is right.
Ordained by God to walk with me, right?
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Just want to make sure.
He said you're going to keep doing that until it doesn't bother me anymore. I thought, doesn't bother me anymore.
Yeah. Don't pull that one on me. I've got a story, but I won't tell it.
Yeah.
Amen. Thank glory. Amen. Let's have a couple of songs.
Amen.
I saw the Lord. No, I did that yesterday. Amen. Amen. Thank God. Number two, I am at. God bless you. How you doing?
Doing well.
Thank you.
bound. Sin did abound. Oh, that darkness on the sins of God's people with water of life just multiplied. I didn't know that was part of what God did, the power of darkness, but did it ever manifest the wickedness of water blind people? It grew worse. If you read where the power of darkness hit Jesus, everybody with him, their sins went worse.
Right. Jesus said that, he said, with the power of darkness, no man can work.
Right. Right. Well, you know, I did an audio on Sunday, last Sunday, at 03. I sure, when I said it, when I made it, I hope, surely must add some hope. Later, I got none. No. The sins just grew much greater on me. Much greater. I didn't know what to expect. So, would you read Hebrews 12?
Hebrews 12, verse 1. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest you be wearied and faint in your minds. You have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin.
Amen.
And you have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children, my son, despise thou not the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. That is through verse 5.
Thank you. You know, sin, when the power of darkness hit, it wasn't new. It just grew what was already going on. Oh, yes. It made sin worse. And I got it on me. Goodness. Amazing what took place in 04. But it took place in years prior. Didn't matter. Didn't matter at all. Sin, 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 sin. You get a man and a woman together, but unless you got sin, I didn't know all that was going on as a veterinarian. I worked in a lot of good stables, real good. I was amazed at what I saw conversation-wise. I didn't know they were setting up opportunity to get together, commit sin. I thought, surely you can laugh with the opposite sex and not have intent of committing adultery. unreal. Strive against sin. Isaiah 59, 15. He that is departed from evil makes himself pray. Now, I'm going to tell you all. And it's God speaking. I did not and was not committing adultery, but all of you were. Oh, what lies you have told. Big lie. Amazing. Striving against sin. Been unreal. December 1st, 15, right?
Right.
We had something happen at Water of Life that just, well, it amazed me. And Kathie knows about it. Anthony, David, Casperite, Paul Peters, I guess. Maybe David Brown. Me. Thank God. Y'all talk about
it? Amen. We had a... It was in the evening, and I had stayed here later or something. Anyway, I was in my office praying, and I happened to go outside to get in my car, and there was a 18-wheeler stuck in the west side grass area, right to the west of the sanctuary.
Right, toward the south end
right.
of the sanctuary.
Right.
Right.
It had pulled in. It had a GPS system, and they wanted to go to Bush, the highway, George W. Bush Highway, and their GPS led them here. And they went to go turn around. Well, it was dark. It was twilight. They didn't see that was not part of the parking lot. They thought that the grass was parking lot, so they just put their truck right into the grass. Well, the grass was soft, and the 18-wheeler got stuck. And it was way into the grass, so they had to call a tow truck to get it out. And I just happened to see it and talk to the driver for quite a while they were getting the tow truck, and then Anthony came in to help. But they had to get a tow truck to get it out. Now, the interesting thing about it is I started talking to the driver. And the driver, it's amazing when you walk in the Spirit and that you will find that when you talk to people, they start spitting up all their sins.
Amen.
And this, you know, I was obviously at the moment walking in the Spirit, and the guy started talking, telling me things that, you know, I wouldn't tell my neighbor, let alone a total stranger. But he started talking, and he said that he was in a situation with his wife, and his wife was an adulteress. And then the gentleman that drove the car, the gentleman I talked to, was the son of a Baptist preacher. And he said that he had this wife, and he said she came home one day pregnant, and not from him. And she wanted him to raise the child, and he did. He said, I will.
Right.
And so they stayed married, and he raised the child. Well, after the child got so old, she came home again and was pregnant again, and not by him. And he said, you know, he said, I'm not going to do it this time. And he was talking to me about the situation at home, about living with the adulterous wife. And we carried on a conversation for about an hour, and then Anthony came and the tow truck came and such. But I have to say something. When God was dealing with my heart back in 09, 10, and some of 11, it would be amazing. You would say, Kathie, God is telling me this is in your heart. And I would first say, no, I don't think so. No. And darn if we wouldn't turn on the news and there'd be. I mean, it'd be some breaking story. And it would totally deal with what God was dealing with in my heart. And I would stand there and look at the TV going, you know, why don't you just shut up? Well, God was bringing it out and he had to deal with it. And God will bring it to the surface, whether you like it or not, if God's dealing with you. And you just have to say, okay, Lord, let's get it out.
Amen.
And that's, I saw that happen more than once. And I remember you were talking to me about my life in college, and I said, I don't think so. No, I wasn't that bad. And you said, and you asked me one day, you said, I see a man here in a brown suit. He said, a brown tuxedo kind of suit.
Right.
And I remember sitting there, and my eyes rolled. Right. I mean, God nailed me. Just nailed me.
Right.
And it had to do with disco dancing, which is way back when. But, I mean, God nailed me. And he nailed me more than once. And you know why? Because it was what Hebrews 12 talks about. It was correction. He was fixing the heart. So that's what happened with the 18-wheeler. Although, by that time, thank God, I don't think it had so much to do with me.
Well, I agree. 1 Corinthians 12 talks about the nine manifestations of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
A wisdom, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, discerning the Spirit's gift of faith, working of miracles, gifts of healing, tongues, and interpretation. I think I got them all. Might not have. But when the persecution took place, that was laid on me, it stopped mostly the manifestation of the nine gifts. Did I say gift of faith? I did.
Yes.
Amen. That really troubled. My heart was just shattered. Ezekiel 6 says that God's heart was broken. The word is shattered somewhere. You read it.
Right.
Somebody did it to me. Well, mine was broken, shattered, to find out what God's people did. My people broke my heart, my Lord. I guess what stunned me, it broke God's heart. Amen. And what's incredible, these people, a lot of them, just go about their business like nothing ever took place. You don't know how many modern black people it broke this guy's heart. My Lord, what I know about you is scary. You see, God can tell me anything He wants to. I laughed when I said to Kathie, there's a guy got a brown suit on. You know, I could tell it was a night dress.
Right.
Amen. And then when you told me, oh yeah, I've been to what, disco?
Disco, yeah.
Yeah. But you think I don't know where you've been?
Can I say something here? We talked earlier. What the sins that you're talking about just aren't sexual immorality. It also is idolatry and covetousness and those kind of sins too. I mean, they all kind of go together. The love of money is the root. I mean, the love of money is the root of all evil.
Right. Well, you know, in the book of Ezekiel, I'm not sure where it's at, but it's there about idols and people that worship them. And they'll die with their idol. Die with their idol. Did you know more than one person has died in a motel room with their idol? With their idol. Oral sex idolatry. Sodomy. Unreal. Adultery. I cannot believe what I heard. You know, I'm a naive person. You think I know more than you do, by far. I know what you do in your bedroom. I know what you do in a car with a man or a woman. It's sick to see someone committing a sexual act in the spirit. Yeah, and know where it is. God shows me everything I need to see. You can't hide one thing from God. Oh, some of you think you're really cute. No, I didn't do that. Oh, no, I don't remember that. Come on, con. You're nothing but a con when you say that. You know what you've done. I've dealt with people. They've done specific things in specific persons, places. Pardon me. No, I don't remember that. What a lie. You think God doesn't know you're lying? You remember that? No, I don't remember that. No, I don't remember that. I don't remember that. I dealt with a guy that went, got 99 years. 99 years. Told me, no, I didn't do that. Six times he told me. Nope, I didn't do that. No, I didn't do that. I don't remember that. I didn't do that. I have no recollection of that.
You know, in that situation, God gave him a supernatural chance to repent.
Yes, he did.
A supernatural chance
yes,
to repent.
Yes, he did.
And he didn't.
And he wouldn't. He went back. Prison, 99 years.
Right.
You know what's incredible? He got one of his arms broke.
Yeah.
God broke the arm of the wicked. You know, that I take no pleasure in this stuff. That blessed me. Everybody's arm being broken. Amen. Thank God. Hallelujah. Thank God. Where we at?
It is 11:33.
Amen. Let's look at Jesus. When he went to the temple. Can we do that?
Yeah.
Amen. They, oh, by the way, the reason that truck came here and that preacher's son, I knew people committing adultery with two men. That would be a female. Now we can move on. That's why God let that happen. God said it. Everybody. Ready?
Ready. John 2, verse 13. And the Jews' Passover was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem and found in the temple those that sold oxen and sheep and doves and the changers of the money sitting. And when he had made a scourge of small cords, he drove them all out of the temple, the sheep and the oxen, and poured out the changers' money and overthrew the tables, and said unto them that sold doves, take these things hence. Make not my Father's house a house of my merchandise. And his disciples remembered that which was written, the zeal of thine house has eaten me up.
He wasn't happy, was he?
Not at all.
About sin.
Right.
Right. It won't ever be. And Jesus in you won't be happy either. Jesus in me hates your sin. Hates him. And you know, sin killed Jesus on the cross. Yeah, our sins killed him. Thank God. My persecutors laid sins all over me. I'm coming out. Thank God that I forgive every one of them. Sometimes I'll pray for 30 minutes, forgiving sin, so my soul, Psalm 143, that's why my eyes are like they are. Then brought into darkness like a man long time dead. By faith overwhelmed. Very difficult to get my faith loose. It's over seduced by seducing spirit. Amen. I will tell you, it is tormenting where I'm at. Tormenting by your sins. Amen. Your sins. Where are we at?
It is 11:37.
How are you?
Doing well.
Huh?
Doing well. You know, in Galatians, when Paul talks about, from henceforth let no man trouble me.
Right.
When you look at that word trouble, when you study it out, it means those that brought, those that caused evil.
Right. Well, you know, in the psalm, it says, break the arms of the wicked and seek out till you find no more wickedness.
Amen.
Amazing. As you know, many one of my people departed from the faith, giving aid to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. Out of their conscience, shared with the night air. Thank God. You know what? I'm coming out.
Amen.
So, what time is it?
It is 11:39.
You got anything to say?
Yes, I do.
Good.
Yeah, first, though, before I begin, I want to take us to Romans 5. I want to show us something, because when Doyle started dealing with this stuff in the last couple years, he brought out something that, I mean, when he started sharing it, it gave me a deeper revelation, because I was brought up under the same seducing spirit. I was brought up under where all you had to do was say, forgive me, Jesus, and it's all forgiven.
Amen.
And that's what they have taught in the church. It's okay, whatever you've done, just say, forgive me, Jesus. It's all forgiven. Well, if you will turn with me to Romans 5, it says different, verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith. By faith. Just saying, Jesus, forgive me, you got to have the faith there. If you don't have the faith there, it says right here, you're justified by faith.
Amen.
Not by your words, but by your faith. So you have to have faith. You have to have faith to get your sins forgiven. And what I'm going to talk about also is you have to have faith to forgive.
Amen.
It takes faith to forgive. I want you to go to Matthew 18. I have an interesting testimony today. I'm going to read this quickly, and then I'm going to speak. Matthew 18, verse 23. Therefore is the kingdom of heaven likened to a certain king which would take account of his servants. And when he had begun to reckon, there was one brought unto him that owed him 10,000 talents. And for as much as he had not to pay, his Lord commanded him to be sold, and his wife and children, and all that he had, and payment to be made. And the servant therefore fell down and worshipped him, and said, Lord, have patience with me, and I will pay thee all. And the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion, and loosed him, and forgave him the debt. Now forgave him the debt. But the same servant went out and found one of his fellow servants, which owed him 100 pence, a lot less. And he said, and he laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, pay me what thou owest. And his fellow servant fell down at his feet and besought him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay thee all. And he would not, but went and cast him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what was done, they were very sorry, and came and told unto their Lord all that was done. Then his Lord, after he had called him, said unto him, O thou wicked servant, I forgave thee all that debt because thou desirest me. Shouldest not thou also have had compassion on thy fellow servant, even as I had pity on thee? And his Lord was wroth and delivered him to the tormentors. Delivered him to the tormentors till he had paid all that was due unto him. In verse 35, so likewise shall my heavenly Father do also unto you, deliver you to the tormentors. If you from your hearts forgive not everyone his brother their trespasses.
Amen.
Now you think that's bad? Let's go to a verse that's even worse. I want you to go with me to Mark 11, 25.
Amen.
Mark 11, 25. And when you stand praying, forgive. If you have aught against any, that your Father also, which is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive your trespasses. Do you hear that verse? Do you hear what that verse says? It says, but if you do not forgive, neither will your Father, which is in heaven, forgive your trespasses. Do you know what happens when your sins aren't forgiven? If you don't forgive, your sins will not be forgiven. Do you know what happens then? That means your healing can't be healed, or your sickness can't be healed. Because Jesus paid the price for your healing. And that price was he got your sins forgiven. The reason they got there in the first place. Do you know your prosperity won't work if you don't forgive? Because your sins won't be forgiven. Do you know your eternal life may be in the balance if you don't forgive? If you don't forgive, your sins will not be forgiven. Do you realize how horrible that is? Do you realize how dangerous that is? And it amazes me how far forgiveness goes. And like I said, it says that you have to have faith to forgive. You also have to have faith to be forgiven. You have to have faith to forgive. I shared before a couple years ago about an article of Corrie Ten Boom. And several weeks ago, God had me put that article back up. But God was after something. God was after something in me. And I couldn't find the original article that I read, so I found another one, and I put that up. And Kathie Courier made a comment on it about the second part of the article. And you know what? The second part I didn't read until she brought that out on Facebook. So I went back and read it. Corrie Ten Boom in that article, if you had not read it, it's on my Facebook page. Corrie Ten Boom had a situation where she was ministering the gospel to the people in Germany after the war, 1947. Corrie Ten Boom spent several years in a concentration camp. And when she got out, she ministered to people the gospel, and she was ministering about forgiveness. Well, while she was ministering, one of the guards from the concentration camp she was out came to the meeting. And he came up to her afterwards, and he stuck out his hand. He said, he talked to Corey. He said, I was one of the guards at the camp you were at. And Corrie Ten Boom realized that he didn't recognize her. Of course he didn't recognize her. She had weight. She was starving then. But she talked to him, and she realized at their meeting that she was going to have to forgive this guard at the concentration camp. Her sister died in a concentration camp. Her father died in a concentration camp. She almost died in the concentration camp. And she realized that God had brought this man before her, and she was going to have to forgive him. She did. She asked God. She said that forgiveness is not an emotion. It's an act of the will. It takes faith. It's an act of the will. And she asked the Father right there. She said, I can give him my hand, but you're going to have to help me. You're going to have to help me forgive this man. And God did. And she was able to forgive him. She said she stuck out her hand to him, and the Spirit of God hit her. And it went, she said it went down her arm, and it went into his hand. And she said the love of God poured all over her, and she was able to forgive that man from the heart. But then the article went on, and it said you would think that from that day forward, forgiveness would be easy because she could forgive the man that helped to kill her sister. But she said it didn't. She said years later, she had some dear Christian friends hurt her feelings, did something behind her back, and she was hurt. And she said you would think that after that situation, it would have been easy. But she said for 2 weeks, she seethed in her heart about what her friends had done to her, how they had hurt her. And she said she finally had to go to the Father again. And she said, you're going to have to help me again to forgive my friends that had done this to me. And she said, you know what? The Father did. He met her there. And she said she had the same feeling, and she could forgive them from the heart. And she said, but it was amazing. The feeling didn't go away right away. She said for weeks, she would wake up in the middle of the night and think she had on her heart what these friends had done to her. She said it was worse than what the guard did, because they were friends, because they were close. And they were people that she loved and trusted. And she said she for a couple of weeks, she would wake up in the middle of the night, and there would be the sin again. And she said, but Father, I've forgiven them. I know I've forgiven them. Remember, forgiveness is not an emotion. It's not a feeling. It's an act of the will. It takes faith. And she said, I've done this. And she finally talked to a Lutheran minister who helped her. And she said she worked it out. She realized she was going to have to just keep putting it off, that she was letting God deal with it. And she said it took a couple nights more. And she said, and then the feeling started going away. And she said she knew the forgiveness was there. And she said a couple times after that, it would come up a little bit. But she could again say, I know I've forgiven him, and it's gone away. But several years later, she said a friend of hers from America came. And he was visiting her. And when he came to visit her, the friends that had hurt her were there in the room with her. And they were talking. And then the friends left. And her friend from America said, aren't those the people that hurt you in the past? And she said, yes, they are. And she said, isn't it wonderful? It's all forgiven. She said, it's all forgiven. And he asked her a question. He said, well, have they ever received your forgiveness? And she laughed. She said, you know, they said, well, I've never, not, they told her, well, we've never done anything to hurt you. We Amen. Never did it.
Amen.
She said, we never hurt you. And she laughed. She said, but you know what? She said, I have proof. She said, I have proof that they hurt me. And she went over to her desk. She goes, I've got the letters right here, how they hurt me. And she went to open the drawer to get the letters out. And her friend walked over to her and grabbed her by the arm. And he said, Corrie. Aren't you the one that preaches that your sins are at the bottom of the ocean?
Amen.
And you have their sins in a drawer. And Corrie Ten Boom stopped. And she said for a couple minutes she couldn't even talk because she realized what was going on. She had kept their sins in a drawer, forgiven them, but she had the evidence. She had the evidence in the drawer. And she said, she stopped right there and she said, Father, grant me the grace. Grant me the grace and the mercy to burn these letters. And she said that night she burned them. She called it a sweet-smelling savor unto the Father. And I looked at that story and I thought how poignant that was and how What a blessing that was. And then God spoke to me. He said, you have some email. And I stopped and I went, you're right. I've got some email. I had forgiven, but I had the evidence. And you know what? God doesn't have my evidence of the sins that I've done, because I have the faith to be justified. And I was justified by the blood of Jesus, by faith. And yet I had evidence in an email. And you know what? It took me a couple days because of fear. I had to overcome some fear. But I overcame the fear, and I went to my computer, and I deleted them all. That's what God was after. He was after something in me. And you know what? God may be after something in you. The evidence, my evidence of all my sins is at the bottom of the ocean, just like Corrie Ten Boom's. And you know what? The person that had hurt me, no more evidence. In fact, I told the Father, you know what, Father? Wipe it out from the books. I said, wipe it out from your books. I don't even want evidence in your books that it ever happened. I said, wipe it from the books that it has never happened. And you know when I did that? When it was settled in my heart, and by faith I did that. The faith was there. I've done it. Things changed within a couple days. They changed. And an issue that had been bothering me for years was solved. That's what God was after. He was after my heart. And he may be after yours. And I'm finished.
What time is it?
It is 11:51.
Great. I want Terry to come with her song. And and be ready. But I want to tell you something that I've learned. And Psalm 143 talks about persecuted by soul. My soul has been greatly persecuted. Greatly persecuted. Sin laid on it. Now, let me tell you, those sins in my soul, committed by someone else, torment me. They come up, they're real, they're alive. In my soul, I didn't put them there. I didn't even know they were put there. I didn't know they were committed. It was hard for me to understand why I pray and I put these off. And then 2 or 3 or 4 days, they're back. No, they're not. That's some more sin in my soul, put there by God's people.
Amen. The psalm says, they cast iniquity upon me. Psalm 55.
I know that. But, and thank you. But I'm telling you, I have to pray to put them off. And I'm amazed, but it's sins that was laid there by God's people. You may have a friend, a close one. Maybe your wife, maybe your husband, maybe your boyfriend, maybe your mother, maybe your dad. Those sins of theirs laid on your soul will trouble you. You have to put them off. Forgive them. Keep praying. Sometimes I'll pray for 20 or 30 minutes forgiving certain people. Sins they put on me. Terry, you here?
I'm here.
What song are you going to do?
God on the Mountain.
Good one. There she is, Terre Brown, God on the Mountain.
Life is easy when you're up on the mountain and you've got peace of mind like you've never known. But then things change and you're down in the valley. Don't lose faith, for you're never. Down in the valley of trials and temptation, that's when your faith is really put to the test. For the God on the talk of faith when you're up on your mountain and your talk comes so easy. Life's at its best, but it's down in your valley of trials and temptation. That's when your faith is really put to the test. For the God on the mountain, He's still God in the valley. When things go wrong, He'll make them right. And the God of the good times, He's still God in the bad times. The God of God in your night.
water of life at an acid time. She said many wicked things about me, some of them to my face. And I'll tell you, I forgive her. Sometimes I'll pray 2 or 3 minutes, forgiven, putting off her wicked things she said to me and about me. No, I won't tell you her name. Might be you. No other name. And no other name under heaven whereby one must be saved. No other name under heaven whereby one must be saved. Just one. Jesus Christ of Nazareth. God has given you the grace, the faith. Speak after me, Jesus, and be saved. God bless.
We invite you to visit Water of Life Church at 1621 18th Street in Plano, Texas. Or for further information, call area code 972-578-8082. That's 972-578-8082. Or write Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. That's Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. This program was paid for by Water of Life Church.